we have this, when we have a bunch of awesome abilities. For example, we could be sitting right here in this room right now, and we can go absolutely anywhere we want in the world. We can have all the skills we could ever dream about. We can fly, we can whatever we want, right? And we do all that through our imagination. And when we make goals, we use our imagination. That's how we create them. We think about, man, wouldn't it be cool to become a firefighter, a boat captain, a paramedic? And that's where it starts. We use our imagination. Now, the unfortunate thing about our goals is that a staggering 92% of people will fail at accomplishing those goals. Tonight, we're going to talk about how to become part of the 8%. The 8% of people that do accomplish the goals that they set for themselves. As I was saying earlier, we're at, in January, the time of year where everyone is creating all this hype around goals. This new year, new me, New Year's resolutions. The other night I was watching the college playoffs, the BCS Bowl. A lot of people watch this, right? Millions of people. I know Bama won, it's okay. Millions of people watch this. And there was that the commercial, the mayhem guy. I forget what insurance company, but he goes around creating mayhem. And he's going around, but this commercial was a little bit different. He was actually doing good things. He was acting as like a road flare to keep people from running into a disabled vehicle. He was standing on a roof to prevent lightning from hitting the roof. And he was talking about how his New Year resolution was to do good. And he was like, as long as you can maintain your New Year's resolution, then I can too. And then he stops and he looks at the audience of the TV. He's like, are you kidding me? You couldn't even last 2 weeks? Implying that everybody had already given up on their New Year's resolution. Now, everyone at the fire station, I was watching at the fire station, kind of chuckled. And I did too, because in context, it was pretty funny. But the reality of that is that millions of people are watching this game, watching that commercial, and building this assumption, this idea, that it's almost cool, it's almost hip to not accomplish your goals. They're making fun of it. So while other people, the 8%, are creating new lives for themselves, helping other people, there's 92% of people out there that are falling into the trap believing that it's cool to not pursue your goals and to accomplish your goals. So one of my mentors, he always teaches that when something's important, something is kind of not making sense to you, to look up the definition. Or if a word's intriguing to you, look up the definition. Because by doing that, it tells you what the word means. It's important because sometimes you learn more about the word and maybe be able to use it in greater context and more sentences, have a better understanding of what other people are talking about when they use those type of words. So as I watched that commercial, I thought, what the heck does resolution even mean? So I looked it up, and that's the definition there. Reading that definition, I just felt, it's like, it's a wimpy definition. There's just no grit to it. It doesn't stand on its own. So I tried to think of another word that I could associate to goals. And the word that I felt fit best was commitment, which is a pledge, a promise, or an obligation. That's a word that has grit. It's something that, as soon as you hear that word, it stands on its own. You know that this is serious play, this is not something to take lightly. So now my question to you, real quick, is what's the difference? And this is an open question. What is the difference, in your opinion, between a resolution and a commitment? Chief.
I think a resolution takes commitment. So,
okay.
Kind of like a commitment would be to be committed to your resolution.
That makes sense. And I think that kind of pays tribute to the fact that commitment is a stronger word. It takes commitment in order to have a resolution, right? So that's what Chief is saying. You can't have a resolution without commitment, which is what I was saying about it being a word that is a little bit stronger, one that we can apply to take more serious when we are talking about our goals. Anybody else? Anybody want to take a chance at what the difference is? There's no wrong answers. It's just opinions. look like you had a stroke of genius, so I'll give you a 4.
I feel like commitment is something more serious than resolution. You take it more seriously than
making
a resolution.
Okay. So I hope you guys out. And those are both really good answers. I think the big difference is credibility. Because as soon as we commit to something, even if we don't tell a single person, if I'm sitting up here and I have this goal and I commit to it, and none of you ever know about it, I know about it. There's that self-trust that we have within ourselves, that confidence that we have within ourselves, that when we commit to something, we have to do it. Because if not, then we're starting to go this way. We're trying to go backwards instead of forward in life. Okay? So as we commit to something, we have that credibility, that confidence within ourselves, that's when we can start moving in the right direction of life. So the objectives for tonight, we're just going to define goals. Again, I like to break down the words. You can take it a little bit further, which we're going to do with goals. We're going to talk about the different types of goals. There's 3 types of goals that we should all have at any given point in our life. So it's great that you guys are all working towards, you know, certain things. But I wanted to challenge you to take it just a little bit further. Have these 3 aspects in your life at all times, and you'll see some dramatic changes. Also, we're going to talk about how to create new goals. Very simple mnemonic that you can pretty much may have seen in other places, but how you can apply these principles to actually create your goal, to then make it as tangible, as real as possible. And then the goal process. The goal process, really anything in life, you have like the external stuff, the influences beyond you, but then you also have the personal, the things that you can control. So we're gonna cover those 2 different aspects. So the definition, I took it all the way to Latin. Now I don't speak Latin. If you Google it and you put in that word, the guy says it really cool. I can't say it with the accent. So I'm just going to say propositum. Propositum. And that which is proposed, a plan, intention, purpose. If you guys think about anything you've ever accomplished in your life, a plan, an intention, a purpose, some heavy stuff. Right? To me, I think that's extremely important and why, you know, we need to take goals a little bit more serious. And then also an aim, main point, principle, subject, or theme. Now, the goals that we should have in our life at all times, I learned this from a former Navy SEAL who's retired. His name was Jason Redman. True hero. I mean, people look at firefighters, I mean, this guy was an amazing individual. And he says that we should have 3 P's, which is a personal goal, a physical goal, and then a professional goal. So under personal, I put a Rubik's Cube, because that's my personal goal. It's something that's important to me. I know it's pretty silly, but I see these kids on YouTube put on a little wrap around their eyes and complete it. I'm like, I need to at least figure this out where I can do it looking at it. I mean, you know, they're doing it with themselves blindfolded. So that's my personal goal. Physical goal. We're all sitting in this room with the intention, or hopefully some of us with the intention of becoming firefighters. Having good physical fitness is important to our success. It could be the difference between helping someone in a great way or in, you know, a less impactful way. And lastly, professional. Obviously, I think you all kind of check that box already by being here in this room. You guys could be doing anything else on your Thursday night, so this is the opportunity I'll take to have you guys pat yourself on the back. So I do challenge you to actually create a new professional goal for yourself, something outside of this, because I think for some of you, it's just part of your life at this point. You know, in order to keep growing, you gotta keep pushing and see how far you can go. So those are the 3 P's. I actually want you to write down on the note card that I gave you with the line side, you can do personal, physical, and professional kind of spaced out. That's your homework for this week. You guys don't have to bring it back. I, again, challenge you to do so and share it with someone. Share what your goals are going to be and then commit to them, okay? But we're going to get to more of that here in a little bit. Everybody good? All right, so when we get to the actual creation of our goals, we have to be smart. Okay, SMART is specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and timely manner or time frame goals. When we talk about being specific with our goals. It's what do you want to do? Who is involved? When and where? How does this happen? Okay? But especially, all of those are important, but you cannot skip why. Why are you doing this goal? Why do you want to become a firefighter? Why do you want to become a boat captain? Why do you want to complete EMT school? When I was in high school, I wasn't a very good student. Kind of my own fault. But I also had a lot of naysayers, mostly in the form of my teachers. A lot of them said that I would be lucky if I would be hired by waste management. Now, of course, waste management actually makes a really good wage and they have really good benefits, but that's besides the point. I had to really hone in on my why. The naysayers were absolutely everywhere, every turn, from when I was in school, out of school, hiring process, hired, today. They are always going to be there, and it's just part of it. And the best way to dissolve every distraction that you have around you is to focus in on your why. Nothing else matters but your why. This is why you think about it, why you dream about it, why it's important to you. So as you're getting specific, ask yourself all of these questions. And don't be scared to think big, okay? As I said, I was supposed to be waste management or whatever. I love my career as a firefighter. I've been here for 8 years. And I'm trying to expand myself, push myself as far as I can possibly go, all right? The next step, measurable. Now this step takes some reflecting. This can get a little bit uncomfortable because as we use our imagination, it can sometimes play tricks on us. If I sit here and I say that I know how to be a pilot, I'm the best pilot in the world, I can do all these little flips and all that other cool plane stuff that kind of freaks me out because I don't know exactly how they work. If I sit here and I think about it long enough, I can almost trick my mind into being and thinking that I am a pilot, that I know how to do it. So we have to take the time to really be clear on who we are today. You gotta look at the skills that you have, the attitude that you have, and then compare that with the person that you want to become. How does that person walk? How does that person talk? What does that person eat? What does that person dress like? All of those things, get as specific as you possibly can and break it down as much as you possibly can, because as soon as you start taking on more of those values, more of those habits, it will help you in your process of becoming and achieving your goals. Okay, so you gotta look at your old way and your new way. Next is attainable. The mind is so powerful, as I was saying, we can go into the future, we can do all these crazy things, but we immensely constrict ourselves when we say if. What if I pass the EMT school? What if I go to become a firefighter? What if I become a boat captain? Our mind expands when we're able to ask ourselves how. Take any goal that you guys were thinking about, even the ones that said they didn't have goals, I know you have goals, and think about how you can achieve it. Not if, but how. And that will help you answer this question about how it can become attainable. It allows you to think about the possible advantages. And another thing that a lot of people like to skip out on because it presents challenges and setbacks is to think about the challenges and setbacks that you're going to face. You know, if someone would have told me ahead of time that I had all of these naysayers and I would have to prepare myself to combat all of their negativity, it would have better prepared me for the situation. So try to think of everything that you possibly can and then figure out how you can attain it. You have to, of course, make sure that your goal is relevant. We're not gonna go to police academy if we wanna become firefighters, all right? The most important thing with this picture here is the consistency. It doesn't matter what you do. The picture on the right says randomness, and that's good in comparison with consistency. But your pathway to success, the pathway to achieving your goal, will look a lot like the randomness, because you're gonna do some things that are awesome, you're gonna take off good, and then you're gonna kinda take your foot off the gas pedal a little bit, reset, and that's okay, all right? That happens, to everyone, okay? The most important thing is to pay attention to that left side at this time and realize that as long as you are consistent, you have that up and to the right, and the stock market people would be going nuts if they saw that with their stock. That's their Bitcoin right there, going up and to the right, okay? So make sure you stay consistent. And lastly with this is your time frame. there are so many studies, it's a crazy percentage, like 30% or 80%. But then again, I don't really like percentages because they say that 17% of them are made up anyways. But I don't know. That was a joke. But definitely set up a time frame. Something, what are you going to do today? What are you going to do this week? What are you going to do this month, this year, etc. Okay? And give yourself a deadline. Make sure that you're doing what you say you're going to do. Okay? This is a really important box because it really breaks down things that are important versus things that are urgent. Too many times we get confused with things that are urgent versus things that are important. Both of them have their advantages and their disadvantages. There are things that are urgent. If we have a patient that is having a heart attack, it is urgent that we get them to the hospital. It is not important for us to tell them, hey, you're having a heart attack. It's a myocardial infarction. It's when the coronary arteries form a clot and getting into all of that stuff, right? It's urgent for us to get them to the hospital, okay? Then there are other situations where we're doing public education. It's important for us to share information with the community, let them know, stop, drop, and roll. You know, change your batteries in your smoke detector every 6 months, okay? So be clear on what's important versus what's urgent. You can see in this box, when things are both important and urgent, we're doing it now. We're not waiting to do it next week. We're not waiting until the time is right. We're doing it right here, right now. If it's not urgent but important, that's where you decide. You know, I have to work out, I have to study. Those are things that are important but not urgent at this time. You might have a week to your test. You know, your exercise is an always ongoing thing. So those are things that are important, not urgent. And you can see the bottom two boxes. You can either delegate. If things are not important and not urgent, it's just a filler. It's there to waste your time. So make sure you take that off your plate, okay? You have to be able to balance your life. We're talking about the things that we can personally do in our life. Balance is important. So many people go in, and this is what happens a lot with New Year's resolutions. Everybody rushes in. They want to do it 2 weeks. You know, I'm going to lose this amount of weight, all this stuff. And then the third week, they don't account for it. It's lopsided. You have to be even. You got to realize, okay, I got to ease myself into working out. I got to ease myself into waking up early. I got to ease myself into studying more. Okay? So have that balance. And of course, your friends, your family, have that balance. Make sure that you still make time for that. Okay? All of these things are important for our life, for us to be happy, for us to feel accepted, to be part of a community, all of that stuff, okay? And lastly, we gotta start at the end. Like I was saying before, we use our imagination when we think about that person at the end of the light. The person that has all the abilities and capabilities and talents that we want. Have that cool job as a lifeguard. We got to start at the end and then work our way to it. So he's starting to become a lifeguard. You got to start somewhere. I wasn't a good swimmer. I had to swim. I was, like I said, I was like a cat in water. I was nearly drowning, but I got it done. Okay. I started at the end. I knew that was a job that could help me get hired at the fire department, and it played into my bigger picture. Okay, it was relevant. So here's the moment of truth, the call to action. All right, commitment day. We talked about commitment a little bit earlier. Here's that dun 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 moment, right? We're not dipping our big toe in the water to see if it's warm or cold or whatever. We're going for it. We're doing it. No plan B, no other options, right? When you went into school, did you think there was another option? No, it's pass, right? How do I pass? How do I figure this out? So she had a light switch go off in her head that said, this is it. I'm paying tuition. I'm putting my energy, my time into this. I am committing to this. So in order to do that, some things to be aware of is to be present in this moment. We have to be grateful. All the opportunities that we have, not everybody gets. So take a second to be grateful for the beat that you have in your chest, the breath that you have in your lungs, the thoughts that you have in your head, and the opportunities that you have in front of you. Understand that being uncomfortable is your new comfortable. There's an analogy that if you take a rubber band and you try to stretch it as far as you can, it can only stretch so far until it breaks. So many of us get caught up thinking that that's the only rubber band that we have in life. Sometimes you have to keep stretching. Sometimes that rubber band will break, and you just pick the next one up off the table that's a little bit bigger, and you push that rubber band further and further and further until that one pops, and you just continuously do that. OK? Okay? Now, as you, if you've ever played with a rubber band and you stretched it further and further and further, I know all of you were starting to feel a little nervous, thinking that this thing was going to pop, hit you in the eye, hit you in the face, something. It's extremely uncomfortable. It's the same thing that happens when we're trying to achieve new goals. We feel extremely uncomfortable. We don't like it, but understand that that is your new comfort. That is what you're desiring. It's almost like scoring a touchdown in football or getting that job, that yes moment, okay? Of course, the pledge you promise to yourself, this is between you and you or whoever you want to share it with. A lot of people will say, share your goal with absolutely everybody, and then everybody else will say, don't share it with a single person. It's what's best for you. You know, if you want to share it with someone else, do it. If you want to keep it to yourself, keep it to yourself. And then lastly, plan. Have everything that we talked about with that be smart. Now, we're almost done. These are a couple things that we can add, some advantages that we can use to accomplish our goals. Okay, so we've talked about the goals. We know how to construct them. We know how to prepare ourselves a little bit. Now, what can we use? What outside sources can we use to actually accomplish these goals? So the top one is the Savers Morning Routine. I got this out of a book called American Morning. Really good book. And he does this every morning. He does this before like 5 a.m. Now, I don't wake up that early, but it's still a really good routine to add into your morning. The first one is silence. That's for meditation. Now, I'm sure, how many of you meditate? How many of you are gonna? Okay, that's fine. When I was your age, someone told me to meditate, I would have given the same look you're giving me right now. I had a mentor tell me that I needed to meditate, that I needed to take some time to disconnect and think. And this is something that I wish I would have known at your age. Because with how fast-paced the world is, how much time we spend on our phones, on our computers, social media, if you really think about how much time we actually sit with ourselves without any distractions, it is scarce. And the people that do those scarce things are the ones that you will see succeed. So take the time to meditate. Read a book. Read a blog on it. It's very simple. And if not for anything, fall asleep. Take a nap. My first couple times trying to meditate, I fell asleep. And it was awesome. I needed a nap. Didn't even know it. I just thought the world was so fast-paced and I had to keep up with it. Until I took a step back and realized that it doesn't have to be like that, my world changed. Next is affirmations. This little girl over here on the iPad. Yeah, her right there. We took her to her first soccer game this past year. And the first soccer game, I don't know if you've ever watched 5-year-olds play soccer. It's like this huge herd, and there's a ball somewhere in the middle, and they just kind of all like shuffle around. I'm not even kidding, sometimes they're still shuffling, and the ball's like on the other side of the field. They're just like herding around. So the first game, she's running around on the outside of the herd. Just kind of like not getting in there. So at halftime, I'm like, okay. You're supposed to go for the ball. Remember we talked about this. The foot, the ball, the goal. Remember? She's like, gotcha, Dad. Gotcha. She just ran on the other side of the herd. Second half. Just left side of the herd instead of the right side. So she tried. The next week, I told Brittany, I said, we got to figure something out. You know, she loves soccer. She's decided, but when she gets healthy, she's just not doing it. So I walk by, and she's holding her up in the mirror, and she's telling her to say some affirmations. Her affirmations were, I am the greatest soccer player in the world, and I can't remember the other one right now. I'm the greatest soccer player, and I'm going to do my best. And let me tell you, little 5-year-old was looking in the mirror, like I had to look away. I was like, she was serious. She was focused, and she meant it. And there's a lesson in that. That's how we should look at our affirmation. That's how we should look at our goals. She was serious and she meant it. And I'm telling you, you cannot make this up. This little girl, the ball goes out of bounds. She's going to throw the ball in. Nobody's open. So she throws it to no one. My immediate reaction, what are you doing? There's nobody there. Except for a clear lane where she ran after the ball that she had just thrown in. I don't even know if it's perfectly legal, but she threw it to herself. Dribbled in all the way to the goal and scored a goal. She believed what she said, and that was the moment that I looked at affirmations and said, it really worked. All right, so say your affirmations. And again, anything that we're going over, if you guys have questions, how to, things that you want to talk about, we can talk about after I'm not going to get into all that stuff. It truly should come from you, but if you want a little help trying to create something, of course, more than happy to help you with it. I know Jesus is really good with all this stuff as well. Third is vision. You have to visualize it in your imagination. Continuously visualize what you're working towards. That's why I like it when you're specific, the way it looks, smells, tastes, feels, all of that stuff, because then it's easier for you to recall. It's not something that you're like, well, that, I'm telling you, like the shoes you're wearing, the whatever. Get as specific as you possibly want. Time of day, all that stuff. Visualize it. Of course, we talked about exercising, reading. I was that kid that never did the summer reading. Like I said, I was a bad student, did it to myself a little bit, and I still managed to pass the test when we got back, but that's besides the point. Now, one of my favorite conversations to have with people is, what book are you reading? It's not, if I see someone reading a book, I'm not even kidding, I'll walk up to them and ask them if it's a good book. We can learn so much from books that I never even realized until I actually started reading books that I was interested in. For example, Sam Walton, the guy that created Walmart, he's dying. There's no way I can ever possibly ever have a conversation with him. But I can buy his book. I can read about how he created one of the biggest empires in American history. Okay? Make sure you guys are reading some books. And lastly, scribe. Write down what you did that day, good, bad, or indifferent. Don't be shy. As you read through it, you'll see yourself go through those ebb and flows toward your goal. And when you're done, you'll hold it up and you'll go, I made it, and I got through this, I got through that, I learned this, I did all this stuff. I like to tell people all the time, they always think that the goal or the achievement is what matters the most. And that's wrong. What we should be working toward, what we should be focusing on, is the process. And by scribing, that allows us to really analyze the process. If you think about high school or middle school or anything that you tried to accomplish, while you were in school, you learned all this stuff, but then at that graduation, it's not like you got that diploma and all of a sudden you're like, hey, I'm really smart now. I got this piece of paper, look how smart I am. It was sitting in those classes every day, 5 days a week, studying at home. That is what earned you that diploma, the process, not the reward, okay? Accountability partner. This is used a lot with fitness. It's pretty fun. If you're competitive, I'm a little competitive. I worked out today, did you? You know, and all of a sudden your best friend's like, yeah, I worked out. And you didn't, you're like, I gotta work out. I gotta get this in. I can't let them get ahead of me. If-then statements. If I do this, then I can do that. If I do my goal 5 days this week, then on Saturday, I can celebrate. I get a sundae, like ice cream sundae, or whatever you're into. Gold star bar. I haven't done this one yet, but this one's kind of exciting. You guys remember kindergarten? You had a good day at school. You get that little sticker. It's kind of the same thing with your goals, right? You get a red one for your personal goal, a yellow one, or a gold one for your physical goal, and a purple one for your professional goal. And every day that you work toward it, you get to track your progress and see, Monday through Friday or whatever, how many times, what you've worked on, what you haven't worked on, and it's an excellent way to track your progress as well. Write down your goals, we talked about that. Vision board is the same thing. The things that you visualize in your head and that why, put that on a bulletin board, so then you don't even have to think about it. As you walk out of your room, have it right by your door in the garage, in your locker at school, whatever it is, and then it'll trigger and it'll remind you, hey, I'm working toward this goal. And it'll keep you constantly focused at working toward it. And lastly is a mentor. Obviously, we have some people here that have come before us. I was one of them. But I've had many mentors help me in my life, and it's been a huge difference maker. I actually have an ebook coming out in the next couple weeks that I'll make sure to get you guys the link that breaks down everything when preparing to work with a mentor. Because a lot of people think it's all about just finding the richest guy and the person that kind of you feel can help you get there, but if not, you have to prepare yourself. You have to make sure that you're ready to be instructed, told that, hey, maybe you're not doing the best steps to get you where you want to go. And then as well, you do also have to find a person that is in it for you, someone that wants to truly see you succeed and not really out there for their own agenda. So there's a lot more information that I have on that in my ebook, and I'll get you guys that link. It's the last slide. Throughout anything and everything that you do in your life, especially with goals, you have to focus and refocus and have adaptability. You guys know, working as fire explorers, you guys just ran a scenario this morning or this evening. You guys have to adapt. If you're not figuring out, what else can it be? If things aren't working, what else can I do? How can I do this? And sometimes your focus might be here. When you first start out, hey, I just want to become a firefighter. Then all of a sudden, I want to become a lieutenant, a chief. I want to create products for the fire service to keep firefighters safe. You can keep stretching that as far as you want to go. You want to become a cook, you want to become a professional swimmer, whatever it is. You can continue to push and push and push as long as you're able to focus, refocus, and have adaptability. So that's all my time for this evening. Thank you guys for yours.
Ready, clap.